Hello, everyone. Sometimes it's good to be unencumbered by the burden of future knowledge. For instance, if I'd known the early days of erasable programmable read-only memories, or EPROMs, were so messy and unstandardized, I might not have set out to make a cheap, relatively universal ROM programmer in the first place. Because the further back in time I go, the harder supporting the ROMs of the era becomes. This is a TMS2516 that you might have seen in some Texas Instruments gear or cartridges from the 70s, and it's my next target for making the programmer a little less relative and a bit more universal. If you're a real 1970s ROM nerd, you'll know it counterintuitively comes after the TMS2716 and happens to be the result of the mess standardization was at the time. The Texas Instruments 2716 before it still had the negative 5-volt rail like the 2708s before it, so when the standards organization, JEDEC, and everyone else came out with the standard for the 27 series with only a single 5-volt supply for reads, TI had to come up with this in 1978, but had to name it 2516 because they already had the 2716, which was more of a continuation of the 2708. To make things even weirder, the TMS2516 matches the pinout of the Intel 2716, but the TMS2532 doesn't match the industry standard 2732 because the TMS2532 matches the pinout of the TMS4732 mask ROM. But eventually, TI also made a 2732. Did I lose you yet? Well, what I'm trying to say is that the Texas Instruments TMS2516 and the 2716 from Intel, Motorola, Thomson MosTec, and so on are pin compatible even with the different numbering, and it's a good idea always to check the datasheet anyway, because as you see, it's not always obvious. Does that mean the programmer is capable of programming 2716s too? Well, unfortunately, these ROMs also have another quirk, so they're not quite hardware compatible with the 2732s that have been supported since the first version of the programmer. Actually, the TMS2516 has two quirks, one hardware and one software. Let's tackle the hardware one first. If you have a revision 2.1 or earlier of the programmer, you'll need to make an adapter socket. But if you've got a revision 2.2 or later, I already made a little modification, thanks to the sponsor of this video, JLC PCB. They make it possible for me to work on projects I enjoy, and when I have extra boards left over, I'm able to sell them without needing to turn a profit. JLC PCB provides accessible, cost-effective, and dependable PCB fabrication and assembly services, making it easier for electronics enthusiasts to bring their designs to life. And I'm not just saying that because they sponsor me, I actually used their services long before we started collaborating. Their site is intuitive, and over the years, they've been incredibly supportive. Even when I tested the boundaries of their design specs, it's honestly been a great learning experience working with them. If you haven't tried JLC PCB yet, you can order your first PCB for $2 and get $70 worth of coupons. Returning customers can grab an amazing deal too, $30 off high-quality 6-layer PCBs with advanced features like VIA and PAD for just $5. They've consistently delivered. Easy to work with, budget-friendly, and reliable every time. Thanks to JLC PCB, I get to enjoy the process and I can offer the leftover boards until they're gone. The hardware problem with the TMS2516 and the Intel 2716 type EPROMs alike is the programming voltage VPP pin is on pin 21, instead of sharing the output enable line on pin 20 like the 2732 and many newer ROMs. That means we suddenly have another completely different pin which needs to handle up to 25 volts without setting things on fire. And until now, pin 21 hasn't been one of them, as it's just been minding its own business. The way I can sell the programmer shield for less than $10 is that I don't have high voltage drivers on every single pin, and it would be complete nonsense to increase the price to support a half century old EPROM. But luckily, I found a way that barely adds any cost. So far, we've only had the up to 25 volts on the output enable pin, the A9 address pin, and pin 1 for the chips that need it. Pin 1 already had a jumper to use the same channel for both 28 and 32 pin ROMs, so I decided we might as well make that a three-way jumper since we might as well reuse that channel for these old 24-pin ROMs. All that takes is another Schottky diode to protect the address line register output, just like we're already doing on quite a few other lines. And ta-da! For the price of a diode and a resistor, we support the first series of standardized EPROMs. About time. Now, if you remember though, we're not quite ready to actually get some bits fried into the chips, as these old things also had a quirk that complicates the software a bit. Usually these chips are programmed simply by applying the programming voltage, setting the address and data, and toggling the chip enable line low to latch the data. And that's almost universal. Except for these, since the 2716 and 2516 expect the enable line to be toggled high instead of low, which means we need a software upgrade as well. If you haven't heard, Henrik Olsson made an amazing piece of software called Firestarter that works on Windows, Linux, and macOS, and has support for hundreds, if not thousands, of different types of ROMs, flash chips, and SRAMs, which makes it the magic sauce that takes this project from a place of just learning how programming old chips works to a real tool you can actually use instead of getting a commercial programmer that sets you back $50 for some of the cheapest ones, up to hundreds or even thousands of dollars for the professional grade programmers. And best of all, Henrik is actively developing it, taking feedback, and is super friendly. Unfortunately though, Henrik is taking some very well-deserved time off from programming, and I tried to find a neat way of flipping around the chip enable line to support the 2716 type ROMs in Firestarter without breaking everything else, but I eventually had to give up. Well, with Firestarter anyway. And since I also have the proof of concept Arduino sketch I originally included in the Relatively Universal ROM Programmer repo on GitHub, I decided to upgrade that. Since Firestarter has done such a great job at supporting everything anyone could ever want, within the limitations at least, the original code had fallen a bit into disrepair, had a few bugs, and didn't even support the new features of the newer hardware revisions. So I took this opportunity to upgrade the code, support the newer revisions, and of course, add support for the 24-pin TMS2516 and Intel-style 2716. And as I'm hinting here, it works. I'm sure Firestarter support is right around the corner by the time this video comes out, but for now, I'm happy to add support for another one of the oldest EPROMs, the type you'll find in a lot of early computers, arcade machines, and industrial equipment. If you have any questions about the proof of concept code or Firestarter or anything else on my channel, the right place to ask is in my Hackerspace Clubhouse on Discord, where you can hang out and share whatever you're working on. If you want to buy a cheap programmer shield straight from me, there's a link in the description and I can ship to about 50 countries. And if you want, you can also grab the source code for free on GitHub and have it made yourself. Either way, thanks for watching.